In this video I plan to transfer the original electronics from the X-Carve to a custom built control box. The thing which will make this video a little different is that I'm planning on incorporating a switch which will allow me to swap between a relay activated spindle and a laser engraver powered by a driver board. I will focus on the transfer and incorporation of the relay in this video and save the laser engraver for another. The first thing I did was dismantle the X-Carve controller, carefully taking pictures along the way in case I accidentally dismantled something I had to put back together. So I did a lot of research into how I might go about this, and again found Martin Balford's control box project a great source of information. However, unlike his project, I'm going to use a 2-relay module so I can power an extractor alongside the spindle, and I will not be utilizing a probe. The first thing I decided to install was the PSU and the panel power socket mount. I decided to use terminal crimps to join these, as I'm a lot better at squeezing pliers than soldering. The new enclosure has slotted front and rear panels. I'm not going to show you how to build this, but I will provide a SketchUp model with dimensions to my patrons. Also, since I've dismantled the controller, it seems I have to cut the panel mount openings by hand.
That is a bit shoddy, but I think that'll do.
I'm not an instinctive electrician, so I had to look up diagrams for every part of this build. I found this image illustrating how to wire the panel power socket and followed it. I will add links to all these sources in the written description accompanying this video on my website.
These are shielded crimp connectors. Hope I've given myself enough room to do this properly. So I'm just going to get on with this and then show you what it looks like at the end. So yeah, I'm not trying to make this easy for you to focus on anything in particular. So I had to swap over to these unshielded crimps, which actually are designed to take a slightly thicker gauge of wire, because the shielded ones wouldn't fit alongside each other. So in this instance, that will actually fit like that, and that's what it's meant to look like. Okay, so I've added some more terminals to another bit of flex, which is going to connect to the power supply unit intake here, power intake, and it's going to then go to one of the relays. And the other relay, I will actually take a cord that will exit from the control box and go to another socket.
I marked and drilled out two openings for a couple glands. These will be for the gang sockets, preventing the cable slipping from the control box. The glands also act like a kind of strain relief.
This is going to go via this relay and out of one of these glands to a socket. Okay, so I've just wired a plug which is going to pass through the gland like this.
I wired one gang socket up and connected it to the relay. The neutral and earth cables go to the gang socket while the live is diverted via the relay. There are two options to wiring these relays, and I am using the normally open screw terminal. The next thing I did was mount the emergency stop button at the opposite end of the front panel. I then run a power cable from the PSU via the emergency stop to the gerbil shield. This means I can finally turn off the machine in case of emergency. There are four screw terminals on the e-stop, and I chose one, which is normally closed circuit in, and two, which is normally closed circuit out, to attach to.
I'm going to drill the holes for the X, Y, Z, the limit, and while I'm at it, I'm going to also drill one for the laser I probably should also add the switch, which I will eventually use to go between the relay and the laser. Because the board is quite thick, I have to countersink the back a little bit with a flat forstner bit. Okay, so I've just cut the extra holes out. For example, this switch fits in there. So what I need to do next is to cut some of this four cord shielded flex to go between the shield and the sockets.
I got a little stuck trying to find some kind of push fit connectors for these four pin aviation mounts. I thought I could use bullet crimp terminals, but I ended up resorting to soldering, which wasn't nice.
What I'm going to do is just try and crimp it on. I'm not sure if this is how you're meant to fit these. I did have a quick look on the internet, and there is something called panel crimps, which look like they might actually do the correct thing.
The trick is to tin the terminals and somehow heat that up with the flex in place. I'm sure there is an alternative to this, and you're welcome to share that information in the comments.
I just wired the XYZ aviation panel mounts. It's not the best job in the world by any stretch of the imagination, but it will have to do. And I'm just going to stick the Arduino and shield down in position just so I don't have to worry about it moving around.
I wired the stepper terminals to the gerbil shield, but in retrospect I would recommend waiting a while before doing this. I later had to access the 5 volt terminal, and this made it harder to do.
Okay, so I've got a lot of cables over here, and what I want to do is I want to take off the limit switches, and I have labeled them, although one seems to have dropped off. Okay, so I've just put these crimp terminals on these three wires, which will go to the aviation panel and then to the limit switches. So I just need to fit these back onto here and then onto the shield. So I've just wired the ground and the spindle enable onto this switch, and I'm going to have to, I should have really connected the cable from the 5 volt point there, and I forgot to do that. So the two pins on this side will go to the relay, and then two points over here, and the switches that way around, come back to the laser driver here. The other problem I have is I've kind of lost track of which wire is which on the limit switches. So even though I know which ones go towards the different axes on the machine, I've lost it here. Maybe I filmed it, so maybe I'm going to have to watch some of my own footage. Okay, so I've just worked out which terminals belong to which limit switches, so at least I can get those done. So I've just tinned this wire off screen, and that's going into the
The pin on the aviation panel sockets are numbered, so it's pretty straightforward to line these up, but if you're not used to soldering continuously, it's worth taking your time and not rushing. The connections for the limit switches are a little more complicated, as I had three white cables. I used the continuous noise mode on the voltmeter to identify which pins were wired to which aviation mount terminals, writing the numbers down and making sure the opposite ends corresponded. After checking all the terminal connections at the control box with the voltmeter, I reduced the length of the drag chain and repaired all the remaining cables for soldering to the male aviation plugs.
Even though I'm using lead-free solder, I'm starting to find the smell a little bit annoying. Probably a good idea to keep this fan blowing any fumes away from me. Okay, so I've just soldered the ends onto the XYZ and the limit stops.
The next thing was to add the second power socket mount alongside the first. I didn't want to power both spindle and extractor via the PSU terminal. This method will give me the option to use different sockets and electrical rings to reduce load and prevent tripping. The final thing to do at this stage was hook up the new gerbil control box to the CNC machine and give it a test. All seemed to be going smoothly until I'd forgotten to move the machine screw which triggered the limit switch, but that meant I could actually test the emergency stop. Everything seemed to be working fine, but then I ran into some other problems. The spindle enable pin on the gerbil shield was producing a current, intended to drive the original variable speed spindle, and was subsequently keeping the relay in a single unchangeable state. I found a really good blog with instructions to fixing this. This involved changing a setting on the config file, compiling a new hex code, and flashing the firmware. If that sounded complicated, well, it wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. The description on Marco DeFeo's blog was pretty good, and I will also provide a link to that in the website article. So I could now turn on the relay as illustrated by the light using the G-code via Universal G-code sender, but the M3 and M5 commands were swapped. This produced a safety problem because simply turning on the PSU and having the USB cable plugged in meant whatever was plugged into the relay would turn on. I got really stuck here and asked Nathan from Opentronics to troubleshoot the problem for me. He found another command in the config file which inverted the spindle enable pin, and this solved the problem.
So Nathan had a quick look at the config file and then he identified a particular command which he uncommented, and it's this one here, invert spindle enable pin.
This wasn't before trying several other things which didn't make any sense to me. As he pointed out, you often find the problem in one place and assume the fix is also there. This isn't always the case with Arduinos.
So I'm just going to turn everything back on and just show you that it works.
I swapped the Deslite for a mini disco laser, and to my relief and amazement, I could turn it on and off with my keyboard.
M3 turns on, M5 turns off.
So the next video will involve me installing the electrical components for a laser engraver within my custom CNC controller box. If you found this video interesting or useful, please sacrifice a thumb or let me know what you thought of it in the comment section below. An article will accompany this video with lists to the parts and other web sources I used along the way. You can now also support this channel by becoming a patron by following the link on screen and in the description below. By becoming a patron, you will have access to more detailed plans of this and future projects. Thanks again for watching.